Sam Neffendorf is just about to launch a new 3-month group coaching program in which he helps people create the life that they desire by figuring out what their real values are, by figuring out what their limiting beliefs are, and by helping them make new decisions and create a new, more satisfying, fulfilling life and change the things that need to be changed. It's very hard for us to figure out what our own problems are because it's in our blind spot. But by having a coach and a mentor and a support group, people that you can talk to, an environment where it's encouraged for you to talk about the things that are important to you in life, that makes it much easier to make the changes that you need to change. So check out what Sam's got to say. It could be very helpful. It could be revolutionary. It could really transform things in your life. The sponsor of this podcast is the European Hemp Company. Listeners of this podcast can get £10 off their CBD oil as well as free shipping when they use the code BenLowreyPodcast at checkout. Just go to europeanhempcompany.co.uk. As well as that, I'm part of a joint venture property investing group, and we've got a mentor called Alexlouise Thomas. And if you're interested in finding out more about that, you can go to financialfreedomwithalex.com. We're based in South Wales, and Alex teaches people how to become financially free. And it may be simpler than you realize. You might not need as much money as you think you do, because I was under the impression that you need tens of thousands in order to get into property investing. But when you combine the resources with a group of people and do things together, it becomes much more accessible and much easier. That's what Alex teaches people to do. So go to benlowrey.com/Alex. As well as that, if you're the person in your household who's responsible for paying the bills, you could save money by switching your utilities to Utility Warehouse. It costs you nothing to go on the website and do a comparison, and you'll know very quickly whether you could save money on your monthly bills. Most people can. They've got an interesting double the difference price promise as well. And also, they'll come and change all the light bulbs in your house for free LED light bulbs that will immediately reduce the electricity consumption. No cost, no strings attached, no catch, and they'll replace them free for life. And so go to benlowrey.com/UW to find out more about that.
Hello.
Hello, Sam. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm good. How are you?
Yeah, good to speak to you. When did we last talk? Was it a couple of months ago? I don't remember. No, maybe it was more.
A bit longer. Yeah. Start of the year, wasn't it?
Oh, man. Was that January?
Probably, yeah. I was number 13, my lucky number in your podcast series.
Oh, Jesus. That's like 5 months has gone past.
Yeah. How's it going?
Yeah, pretty good, thanks. Making progress. Doing
good.
Slowly getting somewhere.
Well,
all the
progress is happiness.
Yes, exactly. I do agree with that. So, what's new with you?
Right, I've been... I've actually been very busy in the last few months. I've been building this... It's an online course and also live group coaching program that I ran a pilot of in the first few months this year, went really well. And so I've put the effort in to turn it into a all singing, all dancing online course. And it's all good to go. Just about to get that started tomorrow. So hey, looking forward to that.
What's the website? Let me have a look at it while you're telling me about it. Okay.
It's called Know Yourself, Be Yourself, Free Yourself. And... Oh, but I'm kicking it off with a free class on the power of negative thinking, which I think is the thing that you saw.
Run us through this. So you've got some kind of online course component, and you've got some kind of coaching group, and you've got some kind of live event as well. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. The live event's tomorrow, and it's the launch for the next coaching group, basically. Oh. So going into one element of the course, showing people around it, and then giving them some good stuff that they can use there and then. And then there's going to be an opportunity to take part if they feel so inclined.
Oh, I see. So it's like an intro evening, so they can just come and hear what it's about. And then,
yeah,
and then
it's online. It's an online.
Oh, we see. So it's a live online. Right. So people can listen in from anywhere.
So it's a webinar, basically.
Okay. So what are people going to get out of this course then? What do you teach?
Well, the full course.
Yeah.
So it's really about practical self-knowledge. So it's not about the who am I? Oh, yeah, I'm all one with the universe and that's great, but then nothing actually happens in life. It's about getting to really understand who you are and what you want in the world, and then being able to take the action that fits in with your vision, all based on really understanding your values and also the habits, which will, the sort of tiny day-by-day habits, which will start to get you to what you want, rather than suddenly this big, wow, I'm going to do this huge thing. It's creating the habits which move you towards living in line with the values that you really hold dear.
Okay.
So that's the first part of it. And the idea is people will be able to just do small incremental steps to become more of who they are, rather than who they've been conditioned to be in the world through their own beliefs that they built throughout their life, through things that they learned from their family at school, some of which is good and some of which not so good. And then the big collective limiting beliefs and stuff as well.
Give me an example of how somebody has been conditioned to be. This maybe it's not making them happy, but that's how they've been conditioned to be.
Well, I think a lot of people follow society's goals. A lot of people have maybe might have been in a corporate environment, for example, and so they have goals based on outcomes, and everything's absolutely fixated on the outcome, and if they don't hit a target, that's bad news. And they've brought that into the way that they actually create objectives and outcomes that they want in their life, whereas if they shift it and start to move it towards the how they want to be and the behaviours which they exhibit, which lead them towards that, and then start actually measuring themselves against how they shift their behaviours, after which the outcomes should come to them, but they're not. It's not necessarily everything. If they can see that they are changing how they behave and then everything around them starts to change, then that becomes more powerful. So it's creating conscious habits rather than just the habits that they've been stuck in for their whole life, which may or may not be making them happy.
Okay. And then how long is this course? Is it like a weekly, how often do you... how's it work? What's the format?
Well, it's 3 months.
Okay.
And they get 10 journeys within that. And the first half of the journeys, these are all pre-recorded videos and workbooks, which they can use to... So basically, they get to know their values, what's really important to them, rather than they've just thought is important.
Yeah.
Then they get... from that, they start to create habits, and just start shifting towards that quite gently to begin with. But again, there's that snowball effect and it starts getting better and better the more they do these things and become conscious of their habits. Habits are actually, as far as the outer representation of who you are in the world, it's really your habitual behaviours, which is what you are. So that's a really key part for people. Then from there, they've got their vision. They create a vision which is in line with the values rather than a vision based on the goals that they think they should have just because people have told them that they should. And then it's about actually starting to then create actions that work along with the habits to start moving them towards that. So that's the first bit.
Oh, that's the first bit. So give me an example of somebody's real values as compared to like what they're currently... living. Like, just give me an example.
I'll give you my values.
Okay.
So my top values, and I'd never really, I laughed at the idea of values when my line manager at Standard Life 12 years ago or whatever said we need corporate values, and he was trying to shape 50 people to all have the same values, and it was just like, yeah, whatever. So I never really looked at values, but then I did start looking at values on some training that I did about 6 years ago, and uncovered my top five are freedom, love, fun, adventure, and making a difference in the world. And those ring fairly true with me. Sometimes they switch around a bit. Sometimes I value security a bit more, and the freedom and the security clash with each other, because I want the safety, but also I want the freedom to do the things that I want as well. And but through knowing that, I've been able to start really making decisions based on what I value in life.
So is the first step, is it better to figure out what your values are first, or is it better to choose long-term goals first?
Definitely values, because if you choose goals before you choose your values, you might choose goals. The analogy is you might have a ladder up the wrong wall and you climb all the way to the top of it, and then you realize it wasn't what you wanted in the first place. So I think values is really key. Right. And then you can set the goals with your values in mind. And I've got a process for that. There are plenty of other processes for it as well. But that's a key part of this course around the fourth week. Once people have got really clear on the values and the habitual behaviours, then moving into the goals.
Okay. Sounds good. And what kind of people is this aimed at?
It tends to be attracting people in their sort of early midlife. So in 30, 35 to sort of 50, 55 year old, who have an itch of some sort that something's not right in their life. They might have been moderately successful in several areas, but there wasn't bringing them what they want, really. So yes, it's really people who aren't satisfied with the life that they've got. You know, if you are happy with your life, then you're probably not going to do a course like this. But if there's something that you want to change, and you're feeling that you're stuck with, you think you've got things that you want to achieve, but they're not happening, or you keep being attracted by the latest shiny object syndrome coming your way, going from one thing to another all the time, then it might be a good time to start looking at this sort of stuff.
Okay, so this 3-month program that you're just about to start, did you say this is the first time you've run it in this format?
I ran it as a pilot group and it was great.
Okay.
That went until middle of April, I think we finished that. And so, but what I've done is I've turned a lot of what we did that just as 12 group sessions. And I've taken a lot of the content from that and I've turned it into modules. So there's loads of stuff people can do on their own. And then there's also a group session every week as well to help with anything that people are getting stuck on and they need a bit of group support or some help with me to get over the blocks or whatever.
So when you do your conference calls, does each person get a certain amount of time to sort of speak to the group, speak to you, ask questions?
What we're going to do is people who there's a group, Facebook group, private Facebook group where we meet, and I'll be in there every day to answer questions once a day of people. So anyone who's got anything they want to ask, I'll be in there to be in touch. And also hopefully there'll be group support going on in there as well as people get more and more towards, you know, get into it and they're all on a similar journey, even if they all want completely different things, they're still on a quest of some sort.
Oh, sorry to cut you off. I was going to say, is there certain themes that are recurring, or is everyone different?
Well, I think everyone's different in what they want in life. Probably some basics that most people want. If you're looking at things like shelter, warmth, companionship, those relationships, most people, those sorts of things. But then it's how people want to express these things, it's going to be different.
I mean, do you tend to end up focusing on certain things? Like, do you tend to focus more on money or tend to focus more on relationships? Like, is there certain things that people's issues tend to gravitate more towards?
There are the biggies, of course. And so when I surveyed people who I've been working with in this field for sort of 8 years, and I surveyed a lot of people who I've got on my list and on social media, and they were, relationships is a biggie. Relationships seems to be the massive one for a lot of people. Money is probably number two, and the two of them together can often cause all sorts of fireworks.
Yeah, that's what I would presume. And do you find, yeah, is it people...
Health is a big one too, and fear about health.
Right. Is it people that are not in relationships and want to be in one, or people that are in relationships and are dissatisfied with how it is, or is it just both?
Yeah, it could be either. It could be someone who's in a relationship and wants to get into another one, or
yeah,
something like that. Yeah, those are certainly big ones that are there. A lot of people just also questioning, what am I doing? You know, am I really happy working in this office that I've been in for the last 10 years, where they've been, had quite a lot of their needs fulfilled at that basic level, but they've not really, they're not actually doing something that they imagined themselves doing when they were younger.
I see. Their overall fulfillment with life and their direction in life, kind of thing.
And this is where the values is really important, because if you're not fulfilling your values at work, that's fine if it's fulfilling other needs that you've got, but you need to be fulfilling your values outside of work in that case. And if you're not fulfilling your values at all, then you're going to start feeling flat and off kilter with what you're actually moving towards in life.
Yeah, of course. What have been your main influences? Because I imagine you've created this format. What's been the main influences on you in terms of, well, the kind of work? I imagine you've combined a lot of different things together.
There's people who are influential to me, and then there's the systems and ideas of it. And the systems of ideas, as you know, I'm an EFT practitioner and trainer, so tapping, and that helps people to go into their negative beliefs and understand them and find what the reason is behind them, and then clear them so they can, good stuff naturally comes in once they've released their attachment to old things. That's a big part of it. I use a lot of stuff that I learned on NLP. I do something called provocative energy techniques, which is based on provocative therapy, which is really being very, it's using a lot of humor to draw out people's responses, and even trying to encourage them that their problem's actually really good, so they start to build some resilience against it, but always done with a lot of fun and lightheartedness, really, so it's not too heavy for them.
Okay.
And so I use a lot of that sort of thing. One of the things that has been really influential to me is just looking at it's my belief and my opinion that people's creativity and imagination, a lot of people's, is pushed down by the way that they live.
Okay.
And by the by some of the norms of society.
Yeah.
Which are especially like the schooling is quite limiting for a lot of people. It suits some people, absolutely fine. Some people really thrive in that system, but it's not great for everybody. So that's a big part of the sort of conditioning and the mind control, which then leads people into lives that they're not happy with, because they're following a route which is either mapped out for them, or they can't find a way to fit in with it, but they want to, without actually really doing this sort of self understanding what's going on behind the scenes. So that was a big thing, was giving people an opportunity to just question the, I'm calling it cultural conditioning in there, could be societal conditioning or whatever, and realize that not all the limiting beliefs that they've created are their own individual ones. There's some huge collective ones which are just taken as read, that you're going to, that everyone follows this, you know, this is the way it's always been, we've always had government, etc., those kinds of things, which don't have to be the case. I'm not saying that this is going to bring down government or anything like that, but it's giving people options to just look at their life through a wider lens.
Do you find some people are more open and malleable and receptive to being coached? And do you find some people are more attached and fixed on their beliefs?
Well, I think that the first ones will come for coaching and the second ones won't.
Yeah, right.
They might get sent by their partner, but then if they're not doing it for themselves, they're unlikely to get anything more than surface results, really. So, yeah, it's like anything in life. Some people are going to be interested, drawn to it, seeking something, and others are going to not be. I think, oh, I could really help these people, but I've got to be real about it. You know, people are going to do what they're ready to do.
Yeah, that's true. The people that already come to you are quite open just to begin with, aren't they?
Yeah. And it's about, they reckon it's about 45% of people will go to a complementary practitioner. That's still a pretty big pool.
Yeah. That's why it's tricky. Like, it's very, like, unless someone has asked for advice, it doesn't really work. It's hard to, you can't really give it. Well, it's not as effective to give unsolicited advice to someone, isn't it? Because if they're not open and receptive and asking for it, it's not the same, is it?
No, what's the saying? It's either truth will set you free, but first it will piss you off.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow, good stuff. I was reading the website whilst you were talking as well. So I was just looking it over. It looks good.
Cool, cheers.
Yeah, so is EFT, I know that's a big part of what you do, and is that part of this program?
Yeah, there'll be a lot, because people are going to come up against limiting beliefs and fear when they try and do something differently. It's going to give them a lot of tools to be able to deal with that themselves in every module, and I'm putting some sort of additional bonus modules in just with specific techniques, guided meditations with tapping and stuff like that. But also that's what the group calls will mostly be around, clearing people's blocks. For example, if someone is, you know, deciding, well, I'm going to take action, I'm going to, you know, let's say they're in their own business and they're crap at making sales calls. Mm. And that's really damaging them. Because they're not getting any appointments, then it's going to, and they say, right, I'm going to start doing some calls. But then when they try to do that, all their fear comes up, although they don't know it, all their limiting beliefs from when they got rejected, when they were younger might come up, or it could be, you know, it can be a million different things have led to this fear that they've got now, being laughed at school or anything like that could lead to, or but yeah, being told that they can't come in the Wendy house or something like that, so they're not part of the gang.
It's weird. It's not necessarily big stuff that has an impact on us. Sometimes it's the tiniest things, isn't it?
That's right. And they're the hard ones to find.
Yeah,
like,
it is, isn't it?
It's easy to work on big stuff with EFT. Car crash or like someone being attacked or something like that. You can clear that sort of the effect of that fairly quickly, so long as you work with it, not exposing them to too much trauma at once. Do it gently. But if someone has been, if someone's mum looked at them funny when they were 4 years old and they picked up a little seed of a belief that maybe I'm not lovable or something like that, those things take some detective work to get back to.
Yeah, that's interesting stuff, isn't it? Because and when it's in your blind spot and when it's unconscious, you might not even be aware of it. So there's like, we have, it's like an iceberg, isn't it? We have emotional reactions and stuff to things that we're not really aware is even there. And yet it steers us.
That's exactly right. And so that's why, you know, you can do quite a lot with tapping and using techniques on yourself. But we've got these blind spots. You said it really well there. There can be where you just won't question that part of life or won't even go there because what it actually is your subconscious mind, your nervous system and your reactions are trying to keep you safe above all else. It doesn't, your subconscious doesn't really care if you're unhappy so long as you stay alive.
Right.
That's the priority for it.
This is why having a coach or a therapist or a support group or something is really powerful, because There's certain stuff you just can't figure out on your own, or you're just very unlikely to. You know, it's not like it's impossible, but the chance of figuring this stuff out without some outside help is very slim to none, isn't it?
Yeah, some people can do it. They get really good at doing that. But most people, I think, it's great to have, like, and it can be, it can work, but it can be with a group, that's great. It can be with an individual, can be great as well. But it's just reminded me of something that's really interesting, what you just said, is people are always, you know, there's such a sort of meme out there in the world, trust your intuition, trust your gut feeling. It's actually, unless you have cleared a lot of shit, your gut feeling is likely to just be representing your previous misconceptions about the world. So a lot of people, their so-called gut feelings just keep reaffirming all of their cognitive biases over and over again.
Yeah, right.
They get stronger and stronger and stronger. You know, we can see it in the world, can't we?
Yeah, that makes sense. I was on YouTube recently, and there was this YouTube show with this therapist. I hadn't seen it before. It's a black guy. And I don't know if it was a TV show or something. I think it was actually called The Therapist or something. And And it was with a guitarist from the Sex Pistols. I don't know his name, but he was some like old sort of rock star guy who'd been a guitarist all his life and lived, he'd parted all his life and he had all kinds of issues from his childhood. And it was a really good episode. I don't know. I'll try and find the name of it. I can't remember off the top of my head. But
I didn't see it, but yeah, it sounds interesting.
Yeah, I think it would be up your street. It was good, it was. Yeah, I'll put a link on it so people can watch it.
Cool.
That's the end of that story.
My fingernail was waiting for the punchline there.
I can't remember what they actually discussed, but I found it pretty insightful. No, what struck me about it, the guy was the guitarist guy. He was like this. He looked like he'd done a lot of drugs for a lot of decades. He was really kind of
strong.
Yeah. And but he was very open. He was very open to the guidance that the therapist was giving him, and he was very curious. And it does help if you're open to what someone is saying, doesn't it? Because
it does. Because even if you're really not open to it, then you're not being skeptical of your own position, first of all, so you're not being truly skeptical, you're just being critical. And you're less like, what's the point in doing something if you're not going to be open to it? You're going to put your foot into something, you might as well give it a go.
Yeah, it's like, I think it takes a certain amount of courage, I think, because you know, if there's uncomfortable feelings and stuff, there's certain people are not willing to go there. It's just too uncomfortable. They're not willing to confront it, and it's almost like they just, you know, like, you know, when a meteor or something, I think if they come into the earth at a shallow angle, they can actually bounce off the atmosphere, like when you skim a pebble and it bounces off the sea.
Yeah.
And I think for some people, certain issues are like that. They even if they come into proximity with it, it's almost like there's too much resistance there, and they kind of bounce off of it. Then they're just not willing to go there, you know.
Not ready yet.
Yeah, something like
that. It's not become enough pain for them, or they're not aware of it. And that's and I think that now this is a generalization, but generalizations can be useful. People who are younger tend not to be affected so badly by these small traumas their past.
What do you mean?
They tend to be they're not aware. They're more resilient, and they don't. It's like the stuff doesn't start dripping into their consciousness so much. Like teenagers and young adults tend to be. Now I know we're seeing more and more seemingly like young people getting triggered by everything these days, but generally it tends to be around the early middle age where people start thinking about their life a bit more and looking back at what's happened and what what's different than they thought it was going to be when they start having these things start dripping in a bit more.
Yeah, that makes sense, because the difference between where you are and where you thought you should be becomes more and more pronounced as the years go by, doesn't it? And like
the six pack becomes a one pack, and then you start thinking about, is my health gonna then start getting the health fears going on as well, and that leads to stress, which leads to health problems and things like that. So
I see. So people become more aware of this stuff a little bit later in life.
Yeah, I think so. But to be fair, I think we're seeing more and more younger people becoming aware earlier as well.
What do you think? The topic of mental health has become quite fashionable to talk about in the media. The media sort of focuses on it a lot. It's kind of a buzzword. What's your thoughts?
On what?
Well, do you think that's useful, the way it's being covered? I'm just curious if you have any thoughts about it.
The way it's being covered, I guess it's probably being covered in lots of different ways, and some of them will be useful and some not so much. I think that, you know, a lot of things get labeled, which perhaps shouldn't be labeled, because it's immediately putting a limitation on something that's going on with people. Now, labeling fits in well with the sort of dominant health paradigm, where they need a label to be able to give a diagnosis, so they can give whatever medication, or they could refer to a therapist rather than medication. Of course, it's not just all about pills, but so people identifying with a label which may or may not be useful to them could be a problem.
Yeah, like you said, generalizations and labels are useful because they help us sort of
it's a starting point,
but yeah,
it can be so much more to it than, like, you know, loads of different things going on. They could all get categorized into one.
Yeah, if something's an oversimplification, it's kind of not useful sometimes, isn't it? It's almost like it needs a bit more detail and distinction in order to actually figure out what's going on. That's kind of my sense with mental health, because it's a very broad label. It's very unspecific, and I feel.
Yeah. What was it that you particularly have seen that you just wanted to? Because I might be able to answer in a bit more detail if I know. Because there is so much coverage out there.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, I think it would be. What gets me, people tend to refer to it like it's a fashionable thing to talk about, but I always want to know, like, if you've got mental health problems, I want to know why and what you're doing about it. Like, what was the cause? What's the solution? Or I notice it strikes me that a lot of people are content with just sort of declaring that they've suffered from mental health, and then that's it. And I feel that falls short of actually a solution, you know?
Yeah, and it's not, you know, they're probably not over the moon with it, but they could dwell in it, perhaps. And there are solutions, and they, you know, again, it's a choice. People can identify with victimhood if they want. Or they can actually, there are options for them. I'm not saying, and that's not always easy. And some things are very genuine, and people, you can't just go gung-ho straight into doing a firewalk or whatever to cure some very serious depression or something like that. But
I'll tell you something else that bothers me about it. It's like, there's the stuff that's outside our control. Like with mental health, let's say there's the subcategory. There's the mental health stuff that you can't control. It's like brain stuff, brain chemistry, brain injuries, things that we can't actually influence. And then there's the category of stuff that it is inside our influence. It's things we can change in our life to improve our mental health. And I would prefer it if people sort of distinguished rather than conflated those two things. Because I think that would be more helpful, you know, rather than putting it all under one banner.
Yeah, and of course they can both be, people can have both going on. So they could be, like what you said about the brain chemistry, but the brain chemistry is often seen as being the cause of the symptom, and actually it really is a symptom of whatever's caused that state to be. So the lack of serotonin in what's classed as depression isn't to do, it's not causing the depression, it's as a result of whatever situations and or specific events or drip, drip, drip things over time have led to someone going into that behavior pattern.
Yeah.
Part of it will be that the brain then carries out these biological changes, and it might be at a subconscious level, it's trying to keep them safe or trying to keep them out of situations which remind them of things that they can't even remember from when they were young. So it's pretty complex, but
yeah, because causes and symptoms are sort of in layers. Like what one person thinks is a cause is actually could be the symptom of a deeper cause, and what somebody views as a deeper cause could actually be a symptom of an even deeper cause. And so, like, a medical doctor might look at a health condition and say, oh, that's a symptom of this, you're low in this chemical, and you know, you need to take these supplements. And then someone like yourself might say,
I'm unlikely to recommend supplements, but it'd be great if they did.
Yeah, drugs, whatever, yeah. And then someone like us might say, no, hold on, the reason, like you just said, the reason you're lacking in that is because there's a deeper, that's actually a symptom, like you just said, you know?
Yeah.
It's layers of it, isn't it? So it depends what level.
Slightly differently, but it might illustrate it well, is I see a lot of time people are talking about, they say gut health is the main cause of depression or anxiety or something like that. So there's certain groups that I see, and the answer to everything is you've got to sort your gut lining out and then your depression will go away. But actually, probably the gut, like what's happening in the gut lining, is another biological adaptation which is going alongside the depression.
Yeah.
So it's they're looking at, it's so many symptom treatments.
Yeah.
You know, one I think you know about CBD oil, which is a great supplement for a lot of people, but it's getting overused, I think, because people think that they are curing something at the root cause by using it.
Right.
And again, it is a it's a symptom. It's another symptom treatment. It's taking something to take the edge off whatever. And, you know, it can have some really great effects, but if you stop using it, the symptoms come back.
Yeah, all these tools, it's possible to sort of abuse and indulge all of them, isn't it? It reminds me of people that do ayahuasca ceremonies like all the fucking time, and it's like. Even something like that can be very useful, but
I did my first one a short while ago, actually.
Okay, how was that?
Fantastic. Really got a lot out of it. I found it was just so quick. If I thought of something, if I felt things excruciatingly painful for a split second and then got some really good solutions. I mean, emotionally painful. The vomiting wasn't very pleasant either, actually, but the actual, in terms of the insights that I got into it in my family and in my work and things like that they just come so quickly. I was actually tapping throughout the ceremony, and I'm not sure if it did something or not. I'm quite interested in tapping with things like ayahuasca and San Pedro, because I think you're already tapping into some emotional stuff, and it seemed to, but I was really processing things really, really quickly, and even to the point that I drank the cup of ayahuasca, and within I was there within 20 minutes. So it was really, it brought things on really, really quickly.
Is this in Spain? You live in Spain, right?
I'm in Spain at the moment, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Was the ceremony in Spain?
It was, yeah.
Okay. And so are you able to go into more detail about how it changed your perspective?
It just gave me some... I'll tell you one thing which I thought was really... Probably the one that sticks out the most was my son, who's coming up to be 8 now. And it just gave me some insights into, you know, how we're the relationship had been very parent child, us telling him what to do and, you know, trying to be conscious as much as we can. But it just gave me some real insights into, you know, inviting him into more of a sort of partnership role in the family, really, like being, it's like trying to give him as much autonomy as possible and discussing things with him even more than we already were, and still letting him, so with the understanding that, yeah, sometimes we do have to pull rank because we have got more experience and we might see things that aren't good for him that he thinks are. But it just, yeah, just giving more, just more, so a shift in, definite shift in the relationship with him, which was really, really nice.
Yeah, I guess I've done it a couple of times, ayahuasca, long time ago, about 10 years ago.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's almost like it removes the kind of, all the mental constructs of your beliefs, your habitual beliefs, and it sort of strips them away so that your sort of pure intuition is able to sort of come through to the surface, and you're able to get the answers from your intuition more readily available and have those realizations that suddenly seem obvious but were actually sort of obscured and obstructed by all your
conditioning.
Yeah, yeah. Conditioning, yeah. I had this guy call me up yesterday, and you know the toad thing, the frog poison thing is kind of...
The one that Tyson did.
Yeah, it seems to be all the rage now. I've never done it.
Yeah. No, me neither.
Somebody called me up yesterday and said, we're going to do it.
Got some toads in.
Yeah, we got the toad. And I wasn't really feeling it. Like, I don't know, maybe I'll do it one day. At the moment, I'm really focused on loads of business projects, and my mind is very much in like financial stuff and tax stuff and, you know, banking and spreadsheets and property, and my mind is in that kind of mode, and I don't really feel like I can just like I really want to at the moment go and do something like that. But, you know, maybe when it feels right, when the time's right, when I'm ready to, maybe I might, you know.
Yeah, well, why not? I mean, I think one thing those plant medicines do that's really good is they give you, it's a day out for yourself where you do come away from everything that's keeping you busy, and it just gives you some really good insights, and it's almost like a reset button. Because I do, although that was the first time I tried the ayahuasca, I have San Pedro. I co-host a retreat using San Pedro.
I haven't heard of that.
It's a similar thing, but you do it in the day instead of at night. And I'm working with a curandero who's trained in Peru for 7 years, and so he does the ceremonies, and it goes on longer. It goes on for about 12 hours. It's more gentle. And it sort of comes and goes in waves.
Okay.
And unlike with ayahuasca, people get up and walk around and go for walk about in nature and things like that, and then come back. But it's very contemplative. It's beautiful, really. It's a really nice experience.
So that's more gentle by the sound of it.
It can kick your ass as well. it's the grandfather medicine compared to ayahuasca being the grandmother. And so it gives it's seen as sort of pretty much similar sort of potency, but I guess it delivers it over a longer period, so rather than the roller coaster ride, it's more gentle, but it still has its moments of quite heavy stuff coming up, but then most of it's a really pleasant experience.
Is that illegal?
It's kind of a gray area, really.
Okay.
So I think it's because they are, these medicines are, they're medicines, and, they've got a certain UN wording about it or something like that.
Right. Yeah, I guess even it's pretty obscure, isn't it? Like, relatively speaking, there's not many people doing this kind of thing, is there, compared to normal kinds of recreational drugs? So
No.
I imagine the government's not really too fussed about kind of stuff.
No, well, it's quite interesting because we're seeing more and more of it's actually, you know, is the government throwing people a bone here by starting to legalize this stuff in America? You're seeing it's getting decriminalized in Denver and then in like somewhere in California. Oakland, I think, has decriminalized all psychedelics the other day.
Oh, right. Yeah. So there's kind of a domino effect now. Like more and more states are just, it's becoming more normalized now, isn't it? Like it's getting to the point where sort of nations that still have it, still have drugs outlawed, sort of seem archaic and barbaric now in comparison.
Yeah. I mean, ultimately, because the war on drugs failed, really.
Hmm.
It was it caused a lot of criminality to be in that. And there's, you know, there's different levels of things. There's the stimulant type drugs, and opiates are arguably less useful. I mean, I guess they're useful for pain relief and things like that. But in terms of like you're comparing them to psychedelics, it's a different situation, really. What people are potentially getting out of them.
Would you do it again, ayahuasca?
Yeah, no, I'm not going to be doing it in a rush because the vomiting was really really painful.
Okay.
But I would do it again. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But I think it's something that to check in with and
good stuff.
See what comes from it.
How's life besides everything we've been talking about?
Yeah, interesting. I'm just looking forward to actually going to the UK for a few months in a couple of weeks' time. So going to spend the summer in England, which would be good.
Oh, nice.
And we're going to come back to Spain, but we might do a bit more touring around as well in different areas, Asia and places too. So part of one of the great things about the way you can work these days and have everything online is opening up those potentials for the people that want to do that.
Is there any particular stuff you're watching or reading at the moment?
What am I watching or reading? I'm rereading Lark and Rose. Have you?
Oh yeah, I like
stuff.
That guy. Yeah, he's cool. Yeah. He puts the ideas really clear, doesn't he?
Yeah, they're great. If I would highly recommend, it's probably about the third time I've dug into his book, The Biggest Greatest Superstition or something like that. The Most Dangerous Superstition, it's called.
Right.
And what's really interesting about it is that it's not just he's not saying, oh, the government's bad. It's that actually it's not possible for there even to be a government because all it is just a group of people and they claim to have their authority because they've been given this authority by the people, but people don't have that authority to give. So how is it possible to give someone the ability to do something that you can't do yourself?
Yeah, right. Yeah, it makes no sense, does it? People are very hypnotized by the word democracy. People take it as a given that democracy is a good thing and democracy is the way it should be. But for me, it makes no sense. The idea that, you know, one group of people decides what, you know, another group of people should be forced to do. I don't like the sound of that at all.
No, I don't. I'm absolutely don't like it at all.
But everything we're taught and told is that democracy is good and, you know, democracy equals freedom. But I don't accept that.
It's the opposite.
Yeah.
it's all founded on a lie.
Yeah. And basically, like, you know, it's one of those concepts that just you can break it down so easily. Like if there's three people and two of you gang up on the person who likes democracy, you know, the other two can decide whatever gets done with the democracy fan, can't they? And that clearly can't be right.
No, exactly. I can think of all sorts of terrible examples. Yeah, like Jesse Smollett, for example, or whatever he was called.
Oh, yeah. Well,
But
yeah, we won't go down that rabbit hole today, I don't think. That can of worms.
no, definitely.
Good stuff,
But
Sam.
yeah, so that's so that, but that is a, you know, and that I really like that. What am I? What else am I? I've been watching. I always like Bruce Lipton stuff. I think I probably mentioned him last time we talked. He's been a big influence on me. His understandings of beliefs and the impact that they have on health and also every other aspect of life. Joe Dispenza as well. Have you come across his stuff?
Yeah, I've heard of him. I'm not really familiar with his work, but I think I've seen bits and pieces.
What I like about him is it's really all, you know, it is important to dig back and find these beliefs and root causes and things in people's lives. But I also think that people get a bit too hooked up on that. And it can, there's certain practices and all they're doing is just look, let's look for more beliefs, more beliefs, more beliefs. And there comes a time where you want to be forward-looking instead. And so people can even fall into that trap of always looking backwards for the limiting beliefs, emotional blocks, or whatever. Whereas in fact, this is where my idea about the habits is really key, because it's about actually creating those behavior shifts to move forwards. And so he does a lot of processes around that. And they're quite esoteric processes. Go, but it's much more about creating the future or creating the now that leads to the future that you actually desire.
Yeah, that's a really good point, actually, isn't it? Because like, it's helpful to figure stuff out to an extent, but you also got to
Yeah.
move forward as well. You know, you can't just dwell, can you?
Like everything else, you can get hooked on it.
Some people get sort of addicted to continual kind of introspection and personal development and spiritual development and neglect to actually build a life, don't they?
Yeah. It's what my course is all about.
Wicked. Well, on that note, so we'll encourage people. By the way, I noticed you've got an affiliate program, so I'm going to sign up on there.
It's not active on this round, I'm afraid.
Okay, all
I haven't
right.
activated it yet, but next time you'll be very welcome to. I'm just doing an internal launch this time.
Okay, fair enough. So,
But yeah, from then I will definitely set you up on that.
cool. All right, so I'll put the link on the description and people can check it out.
All
Good
right.
stuff.
Cool. So I just yeah, I don't know when this is gonna go out, but I if people do get this before tomorrow evening, I'm doing this. There is this live workshop called The Power of Negative Thinking. So we're gonna be doing some really good processes in there, and it's all about clear, like getting clear on these negative thoughts, but not seeing them as bad. Actually, what's behind them, and how can you use that to move you towards the life that you want, rather than always just trying to focus on positive thoughts and push the negative stuff away.
So anyone can join that. That's an online
It's online, yeah.
teleconference.
It's yeah, it just needs they just need to sign up, and then they get the details sent over.
Can they find that on the link that you've posted to me?
No, I'll drop that on there now.
All right, yeah, send me that and I'll put that on the description.
Okay.
All right,
Cool.
Sam.
All right.
Hope it goes well.
Yeah. Cheers, Ben.
All
Good
right, speak to
speaking
you soon.
again.
Yeah, you too.
Yeah.